Robert Dijkgraaf is directeur van het Amerikaanse Institute for Advanced Study. Ooit de thuisbasis van Albert Einstein. Dijkgraaf woont op het terrein van deze vrijplaats van de wetenschap. Hij neemt ons mee naar wetenschappers die hun leven wijden aan de wereld van morgen. Denkers, dromers, verkenners, zoekers. Hun kennis verspreidt zich over een wereldwijd netwerk. Als we al die kennis verbinden, wat gaat dat voor ons betekenen? Zijn wij dan het denkende deel van het universum? The mind of the universe?
Wij zijn makers. We overheersen de planeet omdat we gereedschappen, kleding en wapens hebben gemaakt. We leren van de natuur, verbeteren de natuur en bedenken nieuwe combinaties. Wij maken de technologie. Maar de technologie maakt ook wie wij zijn. Wij zijn Homo technologicus. De industriële revolutie heeft een machine in ons leven gebracht. In 1802 gaf de hoogleraar Johan Beckman het gebruik van al onze vindingen een naam. Technologie. We zien technologie en natuur als twee gescheiden dingen. Maar als een vogelnest of een spinnenweb natuur is, waarom een huis of een computernetwerk dan niet? De natuur is één groot laboratorium. We zouden als mensen wel gek zijn om niet te kijken wat we van die natuur kunnen leren. Johanna Eisenberg laat zich het best omschrijven als een bio-ingenieur. Ze kijkt naar de natuur en zoekt naar eigenschappen die we kunnen kopiëren en verbeteren om bijvoorbeeld nieuwe materialen te maken. Materialen die zichzelf herstellen, die zichzelf organiseren, net zoals levende organismen dat doen.
This would be purely sand beach. There would be patterns left behind by the ocean or by the sea. And they every day they're different and they have different angle. I'm mostly looking for unusual patterns. This one, why one side it has brown part and on the other side it has dots. Completely two different patterns. Why and how these patterns were formed. So what defines the structure and the pattern? And I guess that looking for unusual shapes, looking for unusual structures, if you want to see them, this is where you should go.
You look at that, this is a not living anymore, but it's a natural sponge. This is a skeleton of it. It's fully made of glass, just like we make our buildings and our windows. But I hope you see that in addition to just beautiful glass architecture, it is very regular. It has something like a chessboard structure. So there's one window open, another one is closed. And the lessons that we learn from that is how nature ended up with this specific architecture to make the most mechanically strong material. What if we look at that and we think about a future building? So this building, this 3D printed version, has every structural element that this sponge has, and everything we use in the design. Everything, every element that we use now is actually already used by this sponge. What if our future would be materials that combine smart solutions from completely different organisms? If I were to dream big, this is what I hope we can make this building out of: interesting puzzles and interesting ideas that nature has created and they're probably waiting for us to uncover.
In de natuur liggen miljoenen stoffen klaar om ontdekt te worden. Een onuitputtelijke bron van diversiteit. Toch zijn van alle mogelijke materialen er maar een paar gerealiseerd. En daar heeft de natuur nog eens miljarden jaren over gedaan. Technologie versnelt dat maakproces. Langzaamaan begrijpen we ook hoe we onze techniek moeten verbinden met de natuur. Het is de Braziliaanse neurobioloog Miguel Nicolelis al gelukt om hersenen en machines op elkaar aan te sluiten. Maar zijn grote doel is om de hersenen van verschillende personen direct met elkaar te verbinden en zo een hersennetwerk, een soort organische computer, te maken.
Sorry. Oh, that's my soccer friend, Oscar. Salve. Estamos bem, estou aqui com a seleção da Holanda, querendo conhecer o maior narrador brasileiro de futebol.
Nicolelis is een grote fan van de voetbalclub Palmeiras. Nicolelis raakte geïnspireerd in het voetbalstadion, waar mensen bij elk doelpunt samen bewegen als één organisch systeem.
Going to a soccer stadium for me is to experience this feeling of being part of a whole. It's also a great place to observe how people that are lawyers, physicians, scientists, professors, teachers, they have a very circumscribed life, a very well-behaved life. In a soccer stadium, this is all released. I created this metaphor and this operational definition of an organic computer. Organic computer is basically multiple brains that get synchronized in nature by whatever signal, visual, tactile, auditory, that makes them operate as a whole. And when you're in a stadium seeing the same match, the fans there, they all synchronize. So I think we found what is going on, what happens when multiple individuals are recruited to be part of a structure. I'm calling this an organic computer because it's a synchronized device that is computing in a domain analog that digital computers cannot get there. Flock of birds is my best and a metaphor or a school of fish. You are minimizing the chances of each individual to be attacked by a predator. And as a flock, they are going to get to a source of food and they may get there easier than just the individual birds looking.
Nicolelis begon in de jaren 80 met het meten van meerdere neuronen tegelijk in het brein. Meer neuronen dan ooit voor hem was gedaan. Hij luisterde letterlijk naar de hersensignalen.
The first time that John Chapin and I recorded 26 neurons simultaneously recording a rat brain, first thing we thought was this is going to change everything. And nobody knew, but we knew. We were the first ones to see those 26 neurons firing together. And it may sound little, but for us, that was the universe, you know, that was the thing that changed our lives. And that's when we came up with the idea of brain-machine interfaces, of linking brains to devices. When you let the animals
use only one neuron to control a complex device, nothing happened. But when you get a population of cells working together, they were able to use just the brain activity to control devices. We have a paper coming this week, although that uses invasive technology in monkeys, showing that monkeys can learn to drive wheelchairs in an open space in our lab, mentally. Every movement of the wheelchair is coming from the mind of the monkey via a wireless link. She's driving the wheelchair to the pod where we're delivering grapes. We already have an experiment in the lab where two monkeys are collaborating. Each monkey has its own wheelchair, and they only get rewarded if both of them get to the pod. So the faster monkey helps the slower monkey to get themselves together at the pod at the same time. So we are already showing the brain net working between two monkeys. In 2004, we did the first human demonstration of this concept in Parkinsonian patients, just for a few minutes. But it was the first human demonstration that everything we had seen in monkeys was applicable. That is when we realized that we had something gigantic, and that it was not just a basic science apparatus or paradigm. We had touched something that could have clinical relevance, and it could advance neuroscience to realms that we never thought about before.
We maken technologie die weer nieuwe technologie mogelijk maakt. Technologie werkt volgens dezelfde evolutionaire principes als de natuur. Technologieën vermenigvuldigen zich, veranderen steeds een beetje, passen zich aan. En sommige technologieën overleven niet. Het enige verschil is dat wij de ontwerpers zijn, dat wij de keuzes maken. Althans, tot nog toe. Technologie is de grootste belofte voor het oplossen van de wereldproblemen. En of je nu arm of rijk bent, iedereen kan een goed idee hebben. Suzanne Patnaik is een jonge Indiase uitvinder. Hij werd al verschillende malen onderscheiden door de president van India. Hij bezit een onweerstaanbare drang om met zijn uitvindingen het leven in de eigen omgeving te verbeteren. Ze noemen hem ook wel eens een serial inventor.
This is my home and this one used to be my garage, actually where I started my things from the scratch. So I used to hide all the electronic tools, equipments, because at that age, every Indian parent wants that their kids should focus on studies, should get better grades and all. So, but I was like an average student. I'm not much interested in this like formal education things and all. I am more into this passion towards this technology, innovations. So wherever I get a time to get a chill out or to break, I just start hacking gadgets or to try to invent something.
De eerste personal computer werd ooit gemaakt in een schuur. Dat was voor Patnaik een voorbeeld om zelf ook een maker te worden. Zijn blik richtte zich op de problemen om hem heen. Hij wil sociale technologie maken. Apparaten waarmee je mensen kunt helpen.
I was 16 years old. I had gone to a hospital. I waited outside. My eyes just attracted, just got attention towards an old age disabled person. He was sitting on a wheelchair and I just found that person was not able to speak. He was slightly able to raise his hands, but not exactly able to express what exactly the message he not able to express. But seeing that situation, it really hurts me. So next interesting thing that I found, which is common and which is not paralyzed, which is common, that is breathing. Then I invented a gadget or a model or a technology, you can say, a small gadget which converts breathing impulse to electromagnetic impulse.
Hey, Susan, one quick question. On when you were controlling that wheelchair, with just the sniff, how do you make it, how can you decide whether it goes left or right?
Yeah, sure.
And it designed in such a way that this act as a single switch to multiple switch option. Like there will be option panel, the options will keep on scrolling. Let the wheelchair to make forward, left, right movement, or to operate electrical appliances, or to text message. Options will keep on scrolling. Which option the person wants to activate, that option will get activated. It will just wait for 2 seconds, 2 to 3 seconds, then again it will change. Which option he wants, that option will activate.
For back, for back left, back left, for back right. So in this way it used to work like a robot.
This is your first invention?
First invention, and there was accident-proof technology I have implemented. So the wheelchair would prevent from hitting any kind of obstacles or falling from a downstairs.
This is the one you won awards with?
Yeah. I have a couple of innovations. Yeah, this is the one which is more highlighted and got the award.
When a digital person was doing the pilot testing of the device, and he just, through breathing, he just navigated the wheelchair forward, then right, then stopped. Then he changed the option and activated the bulb. And I saw the tears were falling from his eyes. And I realized that was not tears of sorrow, that were tears of joy. Looking that I started also, from my eyes also tears came out, and I felt that that's the real success which I am achieving. This is the real success.
Wereldwijd bestaat er een netwerk van fablabs. Amateur werkplaatsen met professionele apparatuur waar iedereen gebruik van kan maken. Patnaik wil een mobiel fablab opzetten om mee naar de afgelegen streken in India te rijden.
I'm a maker first, because a maker is also an innovator, a maker is also a creator. So a maker has a free body, is free to do whatever he wants. Yeah, that's, we have created a creators and makerspace type of place where allow other makers to, the makers, the innovators who don't have such privilege of accessing such lab. We just give privilege and access to that lab. I mean, they can access the lab, the equipments, and they can do something. They can transform their ideas to prototypes and products. If you provide space to other makers and innovators, we welcome other makers and innovators to work at under one umbrella. Now, obviously, that's an ecosystem where we can discuss each other, we can critique each other, and finally, a best result will come out of that.
Patnaik is de eerste die een toepassing heeft bedacht waardoor vrouwen in India zichzelf beter kunnen beschermen.
So this is the gadget. She watch in a phase or in a word, if I will explain, it's a smart safety fitness watch. It's the safest watch on the planet. So in short, it has the fitness features, and it has some hidden safety features in the form of a stylish, fashionable digital watch. So on this rapid prototyping, you can see it has some of the fitness features. Option for taking selfie as well also there. And in case of increasing rape attacks, India is in number one. But here, being a wearable, it's safe. Like it has a panic button. When you just press the panic button, the siren will be activated, which is equal to the 180 to 200 decibel sound, which is equal to the ambulance and police siren. And simultaneously, on call and SMS alert will go to the family or friends or relatives and to the nearest cops as well.
De drang om te maken zit diep in de mens. Onze handigheid, onze vaardigheid om nieuwe combinaties te maken met de natuurlijke bouwstenen, is ons ultieme overlevingsmechanisme. Waar kun je in de natuur al het begin van een oplossing vinden? Joanna Eisenberg bestudeerde de manier waarop vleesetende planten hun prooi binnenhalen. Zij zag daarin een oplossing om de wereldzeeën schoner te maken.
If we think about how to make a material that has as little friction as possible. So the way we do it now, we polish everything. We polish so that the surface has as minimum number of defects, because every defect produces friction. Now, what pitcher plant is doing is that it actually creates an extremely rough surface. However, it is high friction when it's dry, so that ants or insects are capable of moving around on the surface of this pitcher plant. But what happens when there is rain is that this structured surface picks up water because it's hydrophilic, it likes water. And by picking up water, it creates a layer, over layer, of a liquid that is trapped inside the structured solid. And at the end, what insects would experience is not the rough surface, because your final outcome is the surface of water, and liquids have no defects. You use rough surface to create ultra-smooth surface. Bio-nano interfaces, where we really developed completely new family of materials that can be designed in a very simple way. At this moment, we can make it in metal, in polymer, in glass, in any material, but the material that would repel what you want to repel. Repel ice, it would repel barnacles and mussels, it would repel blood, it would repel bacteria. It's next generation of advanced materials.
Al sinds de mens de oceanen bevaart, hechten mosselen en algen zich aan de rompen van schepen en veroorzaken grote wrijving. Een probleem dat opgelost wordt met giftige verf die het milieu aantast. Eisenberg's onderzoek aan de bekerplant biedt uitkomst.
These are panels that we put in the ocean to see how different types of coatings survive marine fouling by different species. Only the top part is a regular uncoated material, and you could clearly see how much fouling there is, and you could see the samples that well-performing samples, the one that we're developing in our lab, have minimal, I would even call it no fouling, especially if you compare it to the neighboring samples. There are coatings that would prevent fouling. However, everything that works in the sea these days is biocidal. It means that it kills everything around. So what we are trying to do is to create a coating to which nothing attaches, but it doesn't have a biocidal effect. It doesn't kill anything. It uses completely different mechanisms.
Oppervlaktes waarin geen vuil of bacteriën hechten. Ideaal voor schepen, maar bijvoorbeeld ook voor kunstaders of chirurgische instrumenten.
So what if we talk about scalpels? Now with this scalpel, we can go through bacterial medium, through blood. We can cut soft tissues and end up with completely clean scalpel that didn't pick up either bacteria or blood or anything else at all.
Experimenteren met de natuur. In de 16e eeuw, aan het begin van de wetenschappelijke revolutie, zei Francis Bacon dat we de natuur op de pijnbank moesten leggen. Om haar te dwingen haar geheimen prijs te geven. We doen proeven met allerlei organismen. Met planten en met dieren. Zo wonderlijk als de natuur eruit ziet, zich manifesteert in kleur en vorm, zo fragiel is ze ook. Het ene moment wandel je onbezorgd rond. Het andere moment heeft een ongeluk de zenuw in je rug vernietigd en ben je verlamd. Miguel Nicolelis ontwikkelde een techniek om de hersenen te herprogrammeren. Daarmee zou het mogelijk moeten worden om verlamden weer te laten lopen.
Five years ago, we decided, okay, there is clinical relevance of this thing. And we may make people benefit from brain-machine interfaces by restoring mobility to them.
Prepara. Um, dois, três.
And our biggest discovery with brain-machine interface, I think in a decade, is that if you're exposed chronically to a use of a brain-machine interface or a paradigm in which you're controlling with your mind something and you're getting rich visual and tactile feedback, you start getting, if you're a paralyzed person with a lesion in the spinal cord, you may start getting recovery of motor and tactile behaviors below the level of the lesion, which has never been demonstrated with other techniques.
Nicolelis sluit de hersenen aan op een computer waarmee je eerst een virtueel lichaam en later een uitwendig skelet kunt aansturen.
We need to reinsert in the brain the concept of having legs. That's basically what we do. You know, we started just with the global concept of walking, but now we are actually simulating control of specific muscles of walking, which we never thought these patients would be able to do with their brains.
Vai, Pati, segura, segura, segura. Parou. Respira. Muito bom. Agora a gente vai contrair aquele músculo aqui atrás das costas.
They're getting specialized in controlling individual legs with one side of the brain, for instance, the right side controlling the left leg, left side controlling the right leg. And they're practicing just to be upright and trying to move.
Um, dois, três, vai! Força, força, isso, 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 Pati, força, força, segura, 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 isso, 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 isso!
Then they go to that robotic device, the robot standing on the treadmill, to learn what is to be inside of a robot, because you should not underestimate how different is to be encased in a robotic device. And since we are providing tactile feedback, they are getting tactile feedback from their legs inside of that standalone robot. Finally, they get into the exoskeleton. They now are using everything they learned in the previous steps to use the brain activity to control, to trigger the movements of the exoskeleton. Now they can trigger individual legs, and they are getting the feedback from the feet as they walk on the ground. And sometimes they were just walking, doing about 50 some steps back and forth, just by thinking. Imagine now if a large percentage of them can recover some movement, some control, because for instance, the women in the group, since now she had perineal sensation, she decided to become pregnant. And she actually could feel the delivery, you know? She had bladder control, so she went to work.
Tanto para quando você estava no 0G, né? Dos passos no ar, quanto quando você estava na mesa conseguindo fazer a movimentação das pernas.
Entendi.
Foi muito impressionante, a melhor.
Que bom.
Nós nunca tínhamos visto nada igual. Tá bom?
Makers kunnen in hun eentje het lot van vele mensen veranderen. Zij zien overal technische oplossingen. Zij zijn het die voor de vooruitgang zorgen. Ook Suzanne Patnaik is het levende bewijs dat je met sociale technologie de toekomst van mensen kunt veranderen. En anderen kunt inspireren om zelf een maker te worden.
But when I'm in inventing something, I'm looking at a global aspect. How it is globally it is going to create impact. And it obviously it will start from one place. I'm able to think beyond my imagination, beyond in up to that level that what kind of innovation is going to solve the problem. It's not a normal mind, it won't work. So that calmness, that extra, that power is required to think different, to think that unique. You'll feel that you are able to get that confidence that yes, this is the right decision you are taking, this is the right time to do this work. I feel that it happens when that energy enters, and you will feel a little bit heated, and the energy is just enter into the body. Om Rim Shrim Ghantaka Namastote Nadada Swaha. 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 Om Jom Sam Rim Shrim Ghantaka Namastote Nadada Swaha. I see, I am able to visualize my vision in a form of a dream or in the form of a video, whatever you say. When I am closing my eyes, I am able to see that. That yes, whatever we have achieved so now, we are going in this direction. Or there is some problem in this, we should shift to this direction. Or we should do this to create more impact. So I'm able to scan that 5 years vision.
Suzanne Patnaik toert door het hele land om kinderen aan te zetten om grote dromen na te jagen.
Every successful people and every unsuccessful people are my heroes. Because from successful people I learn what to do. And from every unsuccessful people, I learn what not to do. Like a successful people, you can say like Bill Gates, Steve Jobs, each one of them like Elon Musk. Well, I learned everything, like how they achieve their struggle stage and all. I learned what are the things which they make mistakes and they reach that level. From their experience, I learned that what I should not do and what I should do, so that I can reach that level at early age.
At that time, he was a junior scientist.
So how many people have a dream to be something unique and different? And obviously, you want to be big. Education, everything is fine, but how you want to be different? You want to be like a next Mark Zuckerberg or Elon Musk or next Steve Jobs?
I want to make a rocket on which I can go to different planets.
Wow, this is something really interesting. Like people these days on this Earth, on this planet Earth, they are now making especially to Pluto. Wow, what a vision. Currently the rockets, which is the fastest rocket currently developed, that is able to reach Pluto in 13 years. So can you develop some that rocket that can reach Pluto in
less than that?
Yeah, far less than that.
I'll try my best.
All the best for your dream project.
One day I just saw on television, I untightened the screw. When I just opened the box, I was, wow, that was really Jannat for me. I just exclaimed that, wow, this is something Jannat. I got like something, a treasury. That was a treasury for me. Then I just like collecting all the golds and diamonds. So that was really golds and diamonds for me.
We will obviously want to be like you.
Obviously, I will say that don't be like me, be like yourself. I will tell that be like yourself. And be different.
Yes, sir.
Then just after a few minutes, I heard a beep sound. I just stopped what I was doing, just peeped through the window. And I saw my parents came. Without wasting a single time, I just packed all the circuits and all the wires as fast as possible. I just packed back the box, tightened the screw, jumped to the bed, holding the book upside down. And parents came in.
And currently we are into wearables to protect the girls, women from rape attacks. If they try to snatch your band, they will get a beating, the hands will get burned. But in heater, it will melt the globes. if the person is wearing the gloves. There is GPS also, there is GPS too. Everything is there.
My mom just relaxed on her bed, power on the plug of the TV, took the remote. By resting, she just pressed the power button. Doops! One corner of my house was on fire. All my neighbors, all my relatives are bringing the sand, water. I was like, yes, I did it. I am the scientist. Yes, I did it. I just screamed like anything. Yes, I did it. I'm the scientist.
Technologie is groter dan wij zelf. Al die computers, al die smartphones, al die laptops, al die servers. Wat we met al die verbindingen krijgen, is één grote machine. We maken één machine die de hele wereld omspant. Zo schrijft Kevin Kelly in zijn boek De Wil van de Technologie. Daarin beschrijft hij technologie als een soort superorganisme dat zijn eigen koers volgt en waarin wij slechts een deeltje zijn. Hij noemt dat het technium. In dat rijk zijn wij zowel heerser als onderdaan. Nu staan we op het punt om ook de levende materie op moleculair niveau te gaan gebruiken. Met onze technologie maken we nieuwe natuur.
Oh, nice. So you're looking now an entire set of these TM grids. Look at that.
Door kristallen te laten groeien, onderzoekt Eisenberg nu de mogelijkheid om zelf nieuwe nanostructuren te creëren die de eigenschappen van de bekerplant hebben.
What is the underneath? Is it aluminum? Striped aluminum?
Yes, it's aluminum.
So now you can compare this part to the grid.
Yeah, to the grid.
And to compare the structures that are growing on different places.
Yeah.
Do you see any difference between shapes that would grow on just a regular surface or on a grid?
You can already see the difference.
You see that they're,
they're
attached?
Mixed. Yeah, they're attached.
So when they're growing immediately next to each other, they have a little bit different shape. It's really amazing that out of two simplest possible materials, out of silica and carbonate, these complex shapes are growing. I love microscopes so much.
We are not trying to go and to try to do the obvious science. It's uneven, untraditional, unorthodox combinations that we're trying to do.
Okay, this is my first group meeting in the Eisenberg group. It's really an honor to be able to be part of your group now, and I'm keen to share with you my work and also to hear your feedback and to have discussions in this group.
When I combine in my group, I try to bring mathematicians, physicists, chemists, medical doctors, and designers together. The goal for that is to think about the way these people would address science in unusual ways. I feel that none of these disciplines alone are capable of addressing tomorrow's questions. If we open our eyes and think in a very non-traditional terms about what we can learn from nature, we can suddenly realize there are many interesting solutions that we had no idea exist. And many of them, in fact, are extremely simple. In particular, the pitcher plant idea is very simple, but it is counterintuitive. So everything in it is against the rules that are commonly used in current technologies and well-established rules. And what I feel really interesting and very rich area would be to create technologies, materials that have the ability to self-assemble, that uses environment as a trigger for behavioral changes. I think this is the future, at least it's my take on the future.
Is onze technologie een nieuwe natuur met nieuwe mogelijkheden? Het technium van Kelly? Of is het de singulariteit van Ray Kurzweil? Hij stelt dat er een moment in de tijd komt dat de technologie sneller gaat dan de mens kan bijhouden. De vraag is, zijn we dan oud nieuws? Of worden we één met onze technologie?
Suppose you have an aphasic patient, a patient that suffers a stroke, that destroys the left side of the brain, the cortex, and he cannot talk. But the right hemisphere is there. Suppose you can connect this guy with someone else who can speak, and you can synthesize voice by having a brain net working with that stroke patient. Maybe you can improve the training of the right hemisphere by plasticity, because we know it happens.
Direito. Se você está controlando esse axo, quando você pensa esquerdo, a bola vai para a esquerda e direito vai para a direita.
Here, one subject is controlling the vertical axis, the other is controlling the x-axis by thinking.
Six, minus 6 to plus 6. Now it's a union. But, so it's either if they concentrate very, very strong and they manage to lateralize very well, or if they manage to keep it for long enough, because there's a moving average on it. So if you keep it for long enough, you will also go well.
So they are somehow studying each other. And the strategies that each one uses to control the little cursor there to get into the target, the signals from the brains are being combined. In a few days, we're going to mingle this to see if we can get them to control both axes or two axes simultaneously on a 3D movement.
No.
That's impressive.
Well, if it works out, we will be able to have our next patients working like that with physiotherapists or other healthy subjects to train them faster. So the patients will spend less time to learn how to use the robots and the virtual reality system. So in this, the brain net is in this particular setting is to try to accelerate the training of the spinal cord injury patients. Our lab has now the world record in number of neurons recorded simultaneously. We're getting close to 2,000 neurons now, but I think we need to increase this to about 100,000 to a million to start getting close to a picture. It's like when you do a camera, a movie, and you have just a few pixels of the image, you cannot see very well, but if you increase the number of pixels, you start seeing more and more of the image, but you not necessarily need to have all the pixels of the photograph or the movie to see what is going on.
Hoe meer neuronen je kunt meten, hoe verfijndere signalen je uit het brein kunt oppikken. Als het Nicolelis lukt om op deze manier echt breinen met elkaar te verbinden, kan de organische computer realiteit worden.
The brain is a system that is a product of an evolutionary process that involved millions of random steps that cannot be simulated in a laboratory. Suddenly I realized that the brain is the center of the human cosmology. The whole universe is just raw information, like an empty canvas. And the brain as the true painter, the human brain. Everything that we have, the history of the planet, the history of the cosmos, the history of the human race, if you could somehow sum the amount of information and knowledge processed by every single human brain that ever existed or exists or will exist, that's the universe. It's conceivable that if we improve the bandwidth and if we improve the methods to extract information from this from the brain in a non-invasive way, you could have over the internet millions of people collaborating on a common task, whatever task it is.
Outra vez a inversão de jogada pega aqui na direita em boa posição.
Door alle kennis die we vergaren, zijn er zoveel mogelijkheden om informatie te delen en te koppelen, meer dan wij nu met z'n allen kunnen bedenken. De Homo technologicus heeft het unieke vermogen om nieuwe werelden te creëren. Wij zijn de technologische evolutie. De science fiction schrijver Arthur C. Clarke zei ooit: elke vergevorderde vorm van technologie kan niet onderscheiden worden van magie. Wat wij normaal vinden, zou magie geweest zijn voor onze voorouders. Wat morgen gemaakt wordt, is nu magie voor ons. Want wij zijn tegelijk meesters en dienaren. Technologie is groter dan wijzelf en gaat zijn eigen weg. A mind of its own. The mind of the universe.
Iedereen kan de complete interviews van The Mind of the Universe downloaden via de website. Ontdek unieke fragmenten die je niet zag in deze uitzending. Of creëer je eigen programma.
I hope you enjoyed this episode. If so, you can find the next one on this website. If you're interested in other recommended series, please check out our channel. If you want to stay informed about new projects and series, please subscribe to our channel.